fantastic turnout today, and I want to recognize the Gators for Sustainable Campus and the Office of Sustainability here at the University of Florida, because you all are great partners in terms of what we're doing. A lot of times we fail to remember that we don't all work in isolation, and there's really no way in a community like Gainesville with 50,000 University of Florida students and 16,000 Santa Fe Community College students, and there's also an active sustainability group there, that the city can't do things on their own and the county can't do things on their own with such a great willing partner here at the University of Florida, and the leadership shown in this administration and coming up from the students, which is what I think really motivates the faculty, the staff, and the administration to make bold and difficult decisions that affect our community, our environment, and our world. Gina touched on a few of the things that UF has done. One of the things that I think is most significant, and I'll roll back to the mid-90s, I was first elected in 1996, and at that time, the transit system, RTS, was in a state of what I would describe as declining ridership. The ridership was sort of very stagnant and not going up, and it was about 1.1 million passengers a year. In 2008, we carried about 9 million passengers, and that is almost entirely because of the support of the University of Florida students, as well as the staff and the administration, but really following the lead of the students, because back in the mid-90s, about 97, 98, the student government and the student body led an effort to have a transit fee so that students ride fare-free with their Gator One card. So that has been the primary source of increasing our transit ridership, and we are now one of the most heavy ridership transit systems in the state of Florida, I think in the top five. So that's, again, a credit to the University of Florida and to the students here. The reference that was made to the solar thing, as we call it, is that this year, in 2009, Gainesville became the first utility in the United States of America with a solar feed-in tariff. And it's really based on a model that has had great success in Germany and in Spain. And the idea is that if you choose to put solar panels on your roof, whether it's a home or a business or even an empty field, that you can sell that energy back to the grid and be paid really substantially more than what folks purchase energy from the grid for. We're, for 2009 and 2010, we're paying 32 cents per kilowatt hour, and the fully loaded rate that most people pay from their home is more like 17, 18 cents. So it creates a financial incentive to develop sustainable energy here in our community, and what we have seen is that we set a cap of 4 megawatts per year. And we already have more than that of folks who have signed up for 09, 010, 011, 2011, 2012. We are now working in 2013. And to put that in context, and it's possible it won't all be built, but those will roll forward. So we feel confident that each year we'll do that 4 megawatts. And today, throughout the entire state of Florida, there's about 2 megawatts out there. So in the first year, we will double the amount of solar that is in existence throughout our state, which is, of course, the Sunshine State. And I as Chris said, we're really making it into folks' awareness. Just before I left to come over here, I got a call from the Chief of Staff of Congresswoman Kathy Castor from Tampa, who wanted to get some insight on what we were doing. And I also think it's important to mention that this is not the first thing we're doing with respect to energy conservation, energy efficiency, and renewables. It's actually probably the third big initiative. The first big initiative and the first thing that we urge people to do is to actually save energy and to look at installing insulation or improving their heating and air conditioning systems, weather stripping, replacing fluorescent, replacing old incandescent bulbs with fluorescent bulbs. And if you haven't taken advantage of that in your own home or apartment, you can go to gru.com and see that there are many incentives for doing this. There's rebate programs, there's low-interest loan programs for folks who meet certain income requirements. There's a low-income whole house program that the utility will come in and replace appliances and do HVAC and insulation all at one time. And that, what we're seeing from that, and these are customers who really have a challenge paying their bill every month, we're seeing a savings on utility bills of upwards of 30% to 40%. So that's extremely exciting because it's not only helping our environment, it's also helping with one of the other legs of the sustainability stool, which is to help folks be economically sustainable in addition to environmentally sustainable. So what all of this is, oh, and I should also mention that we are in the final stages of negotiation for our next phase of power generation, which would be a biomass-fueled power plant that uses waste wood from urban forestry and from forestry industries. And part of our analysis for that was that this is a forestry-rich area. We all, in many of the counties around here, including Alachua County, we have a lot of forestry. This is a great school with a great forestry program. And the idea that we have is that we'd rather see forestry operations continue to grow trees than grow subdivisions. And so we have sustainable forestry practices that recognize we want this to be a long-term thing, not a take it all out and move on to the next place. We're recognizing the protection of endangered species and so on. It's based on a model from Burlington, Vermont, and we're really looking forward to that being an important part of our energy portfolio that will offset and will replace much of our use of, or some of our use of coal. So what does all this lead to? We, back in the 2005 timeframe, I asked the City Commission to consider endorsing my signing of the U.S. Conference of Mayors Climate Protection Agreement. And that passed through the City Commission. I will tell you, at the time, the staff kind of looked at it and said, you know, Pekin, I don't think we can do this. I don't think we'll make this. And the Climate Protection Agreement is actually, essentially, it's a local commitment to meeting the Kyoto Protocol. The Kyoto Protocol calls for nations across the world who have signed on to it, which, as you know, the United States has not, to bring our carbon emissions down to 1990 levels and below 1990 levels by 7%. And the target date for the Climate Protection Agreement for the Conference of Mayors was the year 2012. And I'm pleased to tell you that while we won't meet the 2012 timeline, we are on track to bring our carbon emissions for Gainesville, Florida, down to 7% below 1990 levels by the year 2013. And all of these things add up. If you want to see how that is going to be done, and the projects that Gina mentioned and the projects that I mentioned and some that we haven't mentioned, including things like our land conservation program, which is something we're also very proud of, City of Gainesville and Alachua County Forever, Wild Spaces, Public Places, and some people are cranky about it having passed last November because they think the students made the critical difference. It's a two-year tax, and students are citizens and voters, and we're proud of how great citizens here and students here at the University of Florida are contributing to making this a better place. So I say, go Gators in that one. But it will allow us to protect many thousands of acres of additional land, which of course is important for many reasons, not just the carbon reasons, but for water quality reasons and for recreational reasons and for wildlife protection reasons, and really at the end of the day to protect the quality of life and what makes this part of our state so wonderful. So we're very proud of that, and both the city and the county worked hard on that, but it was mostly a citizen-led effort, and I want to recognize everyone who participated in that, including there was a strong effort here on campus to pass the Wild Spaces Public Places program. So I will close on that. The three of us could talk all day about practically any topic you put before us, so we're more than happy to take questions or comments or ideas that might come out of the audience. And again, I thank you for inviting us.